By the 4th of November 1983, NATO's war game had begun to accelerate. According to the script, Soviet forces were pouring into West Germany, Norway, and Greece. We now know that Vladimir Khrushchev had already sent an urgent directive to KGB agents across the world.
The threat of an outbreak of nuclear war is reaching an extremely dangerous point. A surprise nuclear attack on the USSR has acquired even greater urgency and immediacy.
What had unnerved the Soviet leadership so much to issue this warning? It wasn't just the escalation of Exercise Able Archer. It was the suspicion that 8 weeks earlier, the Americans might have just found the pretext they needed to go to war. On the night of the 31st of August, 1983, Soviet air defenses in the Far East picked up an unknown aircraft heading towards a sensitive naval base.
The trespassing plane was already at southern Kamchatka, and as it came out over the Sea of Ochotsk, there appeared a bothered and interesting satellite. And then the plane sent a telegram to the satellite.
The Soviet military were convinced that this was a US spy plane probing their airspace. In 1983, American pilots regularly flew this kind of reconnaissance mission. They would gather as much intelligence as they dared before returning to international airspace. But this mysterious aircraft did not turn back. A pair of Soviet fighters was immediately scrambled in response. First into the air was Gennadi Osipovich.
They said to me, test your weaponry. That kind of command is given rarely, and it put me on my guard. So I tested it. Everything was okay. I asked what has happened. They said a plane has violated Soviet airspace. It's coming right towards you.
In less than a minute, Osipovich had caught up with the mysterious aeroplane.
I am positioned like this. This is him flying and this is me. And I am flashing my lights. Everything is visible. I could even see the portholes illuminated. Two rows of portholes.
As the aeroplane failed to respond, Osipovich was then ordered to fire a warning salvo across its bows.
They weren't tracer bullets. I didn't even see them. They were just normal armor-piercing shells.
At last, the aeroplane began to change course. It broke away towards international airspace.
As soon as I got this information, I reported it to Agarkov, the chief of the general staff. He ordered me to destroy the plane immediately.
Unknown to the Soviet controllers, their conversations with Osipovich had been picked up by an American listening post in the Far East. This is what they heard.
I had no emotion. Even at that time, I had no emotion. I was simply pleased that I had carried out my task.
Osipovich had not shot down a spy plane. In fact, it was Korean Airlines Flight 007 from Anchorage to Seoul. There were 269 people on board.
What can we think of a regime that so broadly trumpets its vision of peace and global disarmament, and yet so callously and quickly commits a terrorist act to sacrifice the lives of innocent human beings?
At first, the Soviet leadership refused to admit shooting the airliner down. Then when they did, they claimed it was on a spy mission and went to elaborate lengths to prove it.
Well, we altered the tape. I had said the wing lights are flashing, so now I had to say they are not flashing. They took an electric razor, turned it on, and made me say they are not flashing, using the razor to imitate the background noise in the cockpit. I did it over and over again. I didn't know you could fake this noise with a razor.
The worry was, did it reflect a lack of control of the military, that maybe some local commander on his own initiative had been able to do this without any direct instruction from Moscow? And if that had been the case, what would that tell you about the ability to use at least tactical nuclear weapons, for instance? So I remember that being a worry at the time.
And I think the Soviet leaders, in a strange sort of way, were deeply offended and hurt. Anything that questioned their legitimacy or their, or the fact that they were civilized people, really got under their skin.
It was not a humane regime, but they felt guilty. They felt affected that it happened like this. So it was a terrible crime. I was very depressed.
In the face of worldwide condemnation, KGB stations were warned that the shoot-down was being exploited by America to whip up anti-Soviet hysteria. It was against this backdrop that Exercise Able Archer was gathering pace.